What's up, everyone? Welcome back to Let's Play Demon Souls. In the last episode, I actually don't remember what I was about to get into in the last episode. I stopped off talking about a little bit of lore, but now we are past the first fog gate of level 2-1, world 2-1, the Stonefang Mine's first level. Now we're being introduced to a new kind of enemy. These guys, they are, I'm pretty sure they use the same model as the Crystal Lizards, except they're just, they have a big flaming particle effect on them. And they're pretty easy to deal with whether or not you have ranged or magic. If you are going in there, did I say ranged or magic? Melee or magic. If you're going in there in melee, you want to watch out for a charging attack they do. It can take off a lot of your stamina and it can kind of catch you off guard. And they do fire damage, so most of their attacks are going to at least do a little bit of damage to you, even if you are blocking. I don't think there's anything hidden in these crates, but we're going to smash them anyway because we hate fucking crates. So a little bit more on the Stonefang Mines and the denizens of the level. Let's see, off to the right. Off to the right are some of the denizens of the level, fire lizards. I think that glowing item on the corpse is a chunk of dragonstone, which I definitely want, because the dragon upgrade is something that I'm going to be using here momentarily. Well, not so much momentarily, within the next few episodes. In the next level, actually, I'm going to get a dragon longsword, which I definitely want. It's one of the more useful items in the game that you can find. Not one of the more useful items, one of the more useful upgraded items that you find pre-upgraded. It's much like the Crescent Falcon, it's quite powerful. You just have to bait these guys into dropping off from the wall, otherwise they surround you, and that's never a pretty situation. There's the lunge I was talking about. Now we can just crawl along the wall here, safely protected by these nice, prudent guardrails somebody was very kind to install for us. So about the denizens of Stonefang Mines. As the Archstone mentioned, they were stripped of their will and pretty much forced to work as mindless, tireless slaves. And something that I'm not sure if the Archstone mentioned yet is that they were also devout worshippers of the Dragon God, who we saw in the post-tutorial level before we were pulverized by his mighty fists. Also, since Ed and Baldwin have come up on the loading screen and we've been able to get a good look at them, they appear to be turning into the Scale Miners, which throws into question whether or not the Scale Miners are actually this race of lizard people, or if they were at some point human, and their exposure to the demon souls or the fog or the mines for so long turned them into the creatures that they are now. Also, I believe Ed is the blacksmith that we find, that we unlock a shortcut to in this level, and he, if I remember correctly, is the scalier of the two blacksmiths, Baldwin being the one who's back in the Nexus with fewer scales. Oh, it's just grass. You always hope it's something more exciting than that. Then again, when it is something more exciting, it's usually a trap. This handle is the shortcut I was looking for that will trigger the shortcut down to the blacksmith and down to the starting area. That's what we pass just right here. Hey, blue summon sign again. Yeah, if you jump off on the opposite elevator going up here around that level, you get to the beginning where the merchant was, and this brings us down to an NPC we haven't met yet. Mr. Ed. Not Mr. Ed.
I haven't seen you around these parts. What does it matter? You need a blacksmith? Show me some coin. If not, head straight for the door.
Let's see. What do you have available for me? So Ed is way more useful than Baldwin because he can upgrade our I don't want to say upgraded weapons. What would be the term for this? Because you have standard upgrades, and then you have the upgrades that add a prefix. Well, he can add... He can upgrade our prefix items, I guess you could say. He also allows us to forge new weapons from the demon souls, but that's not something... That's not a capability he has to offer us yet. That'll come after we give him Flamelurker's soul from the next level. So the Demon Souls upgrade system is pretty in-depth. There are all sorts of different stones in the game with names like Mercury Stone, Sharp Stone, Hard Stone. The basic ones being Hard Stone and Sharp Stone. And there are basic upgrades. And the other ones create branching paths that add prefixes to items, like I was saying. Most of them require a basic item to be upgraded to a certain level before taking them down one of those paths. For instance, you can use sharp stones to upgrade a broadsword to a broadsword plus 3, and then use a sucker stone to turn your broadsword plus 3 into a tearing broadsword, and then you can continue to use sucker stones to upgrade that up to a tearing broadsword plus 5.
Your weapon strengthens it, it alters its character. Wars are transmogrified sprites. Their presence blesses the weapon.
And you can also combine items, like I said, with major demon souls to create new unique weapons. For instance, you can combine, I think it's a winged spear plus 7 or a short spear plus 7 with the lead demon soul with Phalanx's soul to create the scraping spear, which looks like a smaller version of the spear that shoots out once you unlock his fog gate in the first level that we did. You could do that little cool roll just to get an upgrade stone there. It's kind of hard to die doing that roll too, because if you notice, you actually... No, you actually can die from that, never mind. Ignore what I said. It actually is a dicey roll. If you're rolling from the first level, or I mean the first floor where the merchant is, you can just fall straight down to Ed, and you'll be perfectly fine. You won't die from the falling damage there. Okay, and this is the fog gate that lets us continue progress through the level, and sneaky little ambush once again from the pickaxe miner. So more about upgrading. Because, hey, the Crescent Falcon is awesome, and I haven't talked about why it's so awesome yet. So the Crescent Falcon is a regular falcon with a crescent prefix. Crescent weapons get bonus magic damage from your magic stat, and they scale very well with it. The game rates how well weapons scale with your stats, going from E to S, E being the worst scaling, S being the best, and crescent items get an A for their magic scaling, and they also get a bit of magic regeneration, and I don't think they have any other scaling. There's a similar upgrade path called Moon, and Moon gets an E in both strength and dexterity scaling, and a C in magic scaling. Also, you could get a moon weapon pre-upgraded from, I think, Maneater's room in 3-2. And I think around... I want to say it's 40 magic. Up until 40 magic. Moon weapons, I think, are technically better. I'm not sure how much that accounts for if you are doing, like, a hybrid strength and magic or strength dex magic build. Crescent eventually overtakes Moon, but either way, the Crescent Falcon plus 1 from the first level of the Shrine of Storms is just super, super awesome. Let's see, what else? Unlike Dark Souls, there aren't any armor upgrades. You can only upgrade shields and weapons. And for shields, the only upgrade available is the Dark upgrade, or you can upgrade it regularly with Hardstone, which just you can go to say a dark purple flame shield plus 10, or you can do a dark right. You can get a purple flame shield plus 10 or a dark purple flame shield plus 5. And to upgrade with the dark prefix, you need cloud stones. The thing about dark, though, it resets your guard break resistance, the thing that dampens the amount of stamina consumed by blocking hits. It resets your guard break reduction to whatever the default is for the shield you're upgrading. What it does, though, is it raises the magic damage reduction on your shield. So my purple flame shield starts at 60 guard break reduction and has a 30% magic damage reduction. At plus 6, it has 70 guard break reduction. If I then, from there, made it a dark purple flame shield, it would go back down, the guard break reduction would go back down to 60, but the magic damage reduction goes up. And that's a trade-off that I'm not super fond of making. Especially because at some point, before that even becomes worthwhile, I'm gonna get the Dark Silver Shield from Garl Vinland, which is just an insanely good shield. Probably the best in the game. Because it offers so much damage reduction in every category, physical, fire, and magic. Wonder why fire doesn't count as... No, never mind. Answered my own question. I'm gonna spend most of the game using the purple flame shield and just upgrading that regularly. It's already at plus 1. And there's really only 3 shields I'm gonna be using that much. Purple flame shield. Adjudicators I'm gonna throw on for the HP regeneration in 5-2, the Poison Swamp area, the very infamous level. And the Dark Silver Shield, if I do New Game Plus with this character, I'm gonna end up using. Because I probably won't get it until the end of the game. Other than that, you can use colorless souls for foraging. I think I talked about the primeval demons. The slug demons that show up in Pure Black World Tendency once per world. You use their colorless souls to upgrade unique weapons. Let's see. The upgrade stones come in 3 varieties, or 3 sizes. They come in shards, chunks, and pure versions, pure being the most rare, and also you only need pure upgrade stones for the final level of an upgrade, like going from plus 4 dark to plus 5 dark or whatever. And different weapons take different amounts of materials to upgrade, so you want to keep that in mind when upgrading something, because it can make the difference between you having to farm a bunch of extra materials to upgrade it, or not so much. But it also, upgrades do also take the base stats of the weapon into account, except when you forge unique weapons using souls, and then it doesn't matter. Different items also need to be at certain basic upgrade levels, depending on what the upgrade is. Let's see. For instance, the sticky upgrade, which is the bow upgrade. You need a bow at plus 3 in order to upgrade it using spider stones to sticky. Like to make it a sticky compound longbow plus 5 or something. Or just plus 1, rather. And sticky compound longbows are, I'm pretty sure, by far the best bows in the game. I think lava bows in some circumstances can match them, but sticky compound longbow plus 5 is pretty good. And you get all the materials that you need for sticky items in this level. You get a pure spider stone, which you need for the plus 5 sticky. I think from the... After you kill the boss here, we're on our way to the boss. So yeah, there is your basic upgrade primer. Where am I going? All that talking, I kind of haven't been paying too much attention to where I'm going. I'm pretty sure I'm on the right path. There aren't too many alternate paths to get thrown off on in 2-1, but just gotta get my bearings. For a second, I thought this was the place where you get the crisp blade, but I think I'm a little bit just before that part. There's the backstab I was looking for. So just since I've been talking about upgrading so much, there are a bunch of prefixes you can add to weapons via upgrades. I'll talk a little bit more about that before I'm done with the upgrade talk. So there's also sticky, like I said, it adds a lot of dexterity scaling to your bow. Crushing adds a ton of strength scaling. I don't think it gets any dex bonus whatsoever. So if you're doing a strength build, crushing is the way to go. But then again, there are usually better unique weapons than anything you can get in crushing form. There's the switch, by the way, to stop the water wheel so that we can backtrack to this room back here. It's just it's the stairway just past where the guardrail room was with the pure... Not the pure chunk. The chunk of dragonstone and all the fire lizards. There's also quality, which gives a balanced strength and dexterity bonus if you're trying to make a hybrid build. There's dragon, which just adds a boatload of fire damage, and I think it removes all stat scaling from a weapon. There's Blessed, which adds low strength and dex, and adds magic damage to the weapon, which scales off of your faith stat, really good for faith builds, and it also adds HP regeneration. There's a mace in 5-1, the first level of the Valley of Defilement, a Blessed Mace +1 that comes pre-upgraded, and it's really good for the level right after that because of the HP regeneration. There is also, there's Tearing, which adds bleed damage. There is Fatal, which I think adds riposte and parry bonus damage. I know I'm missing something. Oh, there's Mercury, adds poison damage, all sorts of stuff. More specific upgrade options. Overburden. I have to sort that out real quick. There are more specific upgrade options that you can go more into depth with. If you're looking to pick the game up and do a bunch of upgrading, you have to kind of surf the wiki a bit for more specific information. Because I don't want to drop anything. Do I have anything I can drop? I'm at 110 out of 110 item burden, so... Don't want to drop any armor or rings, because I don't have doubles of anything yet. Shit. Wait, do I have a ring of Herculean strength yet? I don't. No, I do! Okay. So, what was that? Are you kidding me? Really? It was grass? Mr. Badass Demon Slayer goes around all day killing hulking monstrosities that just swing huge meat cleavers around and chop you up in like a single hit, but he can't handle a blade of grass? Really? Oh god, that is the best. It was overburdened by like a 1/50th of a pound piece of grass. Anyway. God, I completely forgot what was going on right now. I think we're actually getting pretty close to the fog gate that leads to the boss. I don't remember what's down. Oh, this room! I forgot about this. So what I want to do is I want to bait the fat official into using his fire attacks to blow up these barrels here so I don't get lit the fuck up. I think I have enough destroyed. Should be fine. Just want to break a few. Ooh! A few of these, just to be on the safe side. Now we can fight Fatty, and it's all good. It is all good. All good in the hood. I think. Just gonna chew on some grass here. Some of my goddamn 3-ton grass. It makes it even better that I've been pumping my strength stat up. And that I can't hold the grass. I mean, within the game systems, vitality is what's responsible for your item burden, but... You know, strength-based, barbaric-ass warrior. Gets overburdened by a piece of grass. That kills me. The There's an ambush up ahead, and I can't remember exactly where it hits. There's a falling rock that's going to be somewhere. I love the way the spider webs here look. God. This is such a creepy area. Really fucks with your inner arachnophobe. Oh, I see where the ambush area is. It's a pretty shitty ambush, though. I'm gonna fall and break his knees after throwing a boulder at me. Like a punk. Punks get backstabbed. Thinking about how I first got really interested in Demon's Souls during the 2009 VGAs of all places. I remember how I first heard about it. It didn't get nominated for Best RPG, and a lot of people were really upset by that. And at the time, I thought that was just bizarre, because one, I'd never heard of it, I'd never seen anything about it, and then all of a sudden, oh, how can Demon's Souls not be nominated? How can this not be winning? Blah, blah, blah. And at the time, I thought, it's not like it could win against Dragon Age Origins anyway. What heresy would that be? And then I tried Demon's Souls out, I think in January, and I totally understood what the outrage was all about. It's like, I love Dragon Age Origins, but holy shit, does it not hold a candle to Demon's Souls. It really doesn't. I think this elevator takes us down to the boss area. It's like Dragon Age Origins, Final Fantasy VIII, that's all I need. A month later, Demon's Souls comes out. Holy shit, this is the best thing ever. I love Demon's Souls. And then Dark Souls came out in 2011, and somehow was even better. Just super awesome. And if you haven't guessed, based on all of the spider webs that are adhering scale miners to the wall and the chunks of spider stone, the boss is a spider. I know, I just ruined the whole plot of the level for you, but yeah, it's a spider. It's a spider, guys. No spoilers here. Why the fuck do I even have a throwing knife? The throwing knife and, what is it, the secret dagger or something? There are items in this game that I'm just baffled that I somehow pick up. I hate Soul Remains, too. I hate that Soul Remains weigh anything. I'd be fine with them just taking up a slot in my inventory, which has technically infinite slots, if it just didn't weigh anything. But you end up amassing like 20 or 30 of them before you realize, and it's like, oh hey, I'm lacking 3 pounds that I could be using for more useful shit, like a blade of grass. I want to drop the pickaxe. It's not necessary for the fight, but I'm just over preparing for it. I'm gonna put a ring of flame resistance on, because a few of his stronger attacks are flame based, and I cannot fully block them with the purple flame shield. Alrighty, picking bullshit up would overburden me. Eh, why not? Let's show off, how summoning people works. Let's bring Darkblaze 07 into the world. I will birth him like he is my child. I'm gonna birth the ghost of Darkblaze 07. I already got invaded. Might as well, bring a friend along for an easy boss fight. Is he gonna join me? He doesn't appear to be accepting yet. Doo-doo-doo. I feel like this is one of those special occasions that deserves elevator music. But I actually have a better plan to fill this exhilarating wait. So when I was talking about how I discovered Demon's Souls and my the love for this series that would blossom from that moment, I was also thinking about something else I kind of hate, which recently I was reading this hack article from GameCola called Games That Secretly Suck Demon's Souls. And I will give it credit for one line or one paragraph. And it goes something like, the game drops you off in this little practice world and teaches you the buttons and holds your hand so you don't get scared. But then it throws you into a boss fight with a giant creature that can kill you in one hit. Why? Because Demon Souls wasn't hugged as a child, so it wants to make sure you never know the warmth of safety again. That's why. And even though the article is ridiculous and, like I said, hacky, that's a little gem buried beneath all the shit. See, with the Ring of Flame resistance and the Purple Flame Shield, it's really just overkill for the approach to this boss. After that, you could just bait him into doing the butt stomp. Him or her. Actually, I always imagine it's a her because I think of the big metal Spider Queen from Brutal Legend. When you see her mouth light up like a furnace, that's your cue to run way back to the back of the room where the fog gate is, lest you be incinerated like a roasted pig. And part of what makes this fight so easy is that while that flame attack is going on, you have so much time to buff your weapon, to change gear if you want, to heal, to do whatever you need to do. If you aren't going into this with flame resistance at all, those fireballs actually do a pretty decent amount of damage if blocked, so that can be a pain. Her melee attacks, though, they don't consume enough stamina to actually be threatening. Like, I'll point it out the next time she does it. The web attack is just kind of an annoyance. It's pesky. It's not a big deal, though. It's a big deal if you're trying to roll through the fireballs, and she's doing the furnace attack again. I hate that. Hate it. The attack where she lashes out with her front two legs, and she has kind of like the X strike motion, that attack is triggered by standing within a certain range of her, and you can bait that out pretty easily usually. The thing is, that attack, it doesn't take off enough stamina to be threatening, because here's the thing. If you lower your shield as soon as you block it, you regenerate all of your stamina by the time she starts her next attack up. So if you want to, you really can just stand in melee range. I'm just playing it overly safe. Furnace attack again. I feel like I should be taking the time during the furnace attack to be reading a bedtime story to a child or something. Or to explain in detail the systems of the game and how to succeed to the writer of that Game Cola article. There is a tendency to overindulge the player with tutorials, and Demon Souls is an exploration of what happens when you turn that fast of game design nearly 180 degrees around and explain very little, except the most basic functions of the game, which are just what the controls are. And just for the minimum level of success in this game, that's all you really need. It's kind of fascinating. You get so much fulfillment out of this game, though. When you discover a nuance of the game, it's gratifying because you did it. You discovered it. When you master a mechanic, it's fulfilling because you worked for it, and nobody told you how. You own your own accomplishments in this game, and the game doesn't rob you of that, of feeling that way. You feel frightened by the lack of knowing what can happen in a level. With so little knowledge about the game, anything is possible. It's all a mystery. Anything could be a secret or a side quest. Anything could trigger a cascade of events. You go around thinking, oh god, what's gonna happen if I do this? What does this do? Do I risk touching that? If I venture down this stairwell, what is gonna be waiting? And yet, that same element of the unknown triggers a sense of almost childlike wonder, of wanderlust. After all, the prospect of the unknown is psychologically dreadful to humans, but the implications of having no idea what is or isn't possible of not knowing what you're going to find is also intensely alluring. God, I'm getting wires crossed with this fight where I'm switching to two-handed mode when I mean to be attacking. I want to switch to two-hand mode before I attack, but not as the attack. It makes the world seem boundless and absorbing. When you combine that with the rich atmosphere of the game and a world that already feels so well constructed and lived in, you really are, in the case of this series, transported somewhere else. The value of mystery is that anything seems possible. And once you've cut your teeth on the monsters and the levels this game has to throw at you, your growth as a player is noticeable. Where once you'd round a corner with your shield held high, fearing what might be around that corner, and where once you would escape a battle with just a few minor enemies, mentally stressed and with your character bleeding, you start to notice that the parries become more effortless, and you stand triumphantly with your foot on the corpse of the stronger enemies. Where most games empower the player by making their character big, cool guys who are wildly overpowered compared to the game's enemies, Demon's Souls does the exact opposite. It empowers the player by forcing them to master the game and overcome enemies who are as strong or stronger than the player. There is this concept called effort justification, which is, it's when you rationalize the effort you expend in pursuit of a goal by attributing more value to the goal itself, making the payoff seem worthwhile, even in situations where it objectively isn't. And I'm not saying that's the case for Demon's Souls. It's why we take such immense satisfaction in overcoming challenges, even if we know the challenge is arbitrary, and we could just as easily go from point A to point B without the hurdles in between. Effort justification, your phrase for the day. And I think I can get to the lizard. No, because the pickaxe guys in 2-2 are stronger than the 2-1. The 2-1-1s. Hey, there's blue summon sign again from Dark Blaze, or probably Dark Blaze, who didn't accept my summon. They wound me so. Anyway, back to the Nexus, where I think we finally have some new NPC dialogue waiting for us to expand our horizons and our understanding of the overarching plot of the game.
I'm sorry. Please leave me alone.
Aw, Crestfallen Warrior apologized to us.
Who are you? I don't remember anything. Who are you?
I can forge weapons. Well, old Ed's still up to his old strange ways, is he? Even the demons don't know what to do with him, huh? God must save Zeke. Back in my younger years, I had the strength of an ox. The miners would always ask me to clear out the bear bugs, which I pummeled with my bare hands. But even I couldn't beat them. So I lobbed them into the lava pits. I'm pretty strong myself. But even I don't compare to old Ed. Man's a beast, I tell you. The man must eat dragon tails and wishing stones. If you heed my advice, you'll avoid crossing him. I reckon he'd prove a lot more trouble than most demons.
Oh,
Deep inside Stonefang Mine is an ancient dragon burial ground. The bones of the dragons exude ore. Deep inside Stonefang, the bone.
Okay, that's it from you, Baldwin. I can tell you. Yeah, he's hinting at that ancient dragon burial ground, the shrine to the dragon god that the scale miners maintain slavishly. Yeah, I just want to get a better look at the scales on Ed. On Baldwin. Yeah, you can just barely see the in-game model, the scales that are slightly covered up by the gloves. Anyway, that's gonna end this episode. Thank you guys for watching.
Hello.
Take it easy. Have a good one.